Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting in 2024 of Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have one item on our public agenda today, and that is an evidence session with the Minister for Public Finance on Scotland's Commissioner Landscape. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Katrina McLean, Deputy Director, Public Body Support Unit, and Stephen McGregor, Head of Parliament and Legislation Unit. I welcome you all to the meeting and I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Good morning, Minister. Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Delighted to be here this morning to give evidence on the session you're undertaking and to Commissioner supported by the SPCB. And you have seen the letter from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance that outlines the government's position in regard to a number of these matters, and very much looking forward to giving more detail and answering your questions on that. I think at the outset I'd like to say that we share a common interest in this. The government is very keen that the public sector landscape is as efficient and effective as possible, and certainly the broader work that I'm leading and taking forward in my new role round about review of the broader public sector landscape, this piece of work very much that you're undertaking very much falls within that, to make sure we've got as efficient delivery as possible for the people of Scotland within the budget constraints we have. I think there's a very important point I'd like to make, which you very well understand, round about the independence from government of the commissioners that are sponsored by the SPCB in the Parliament. So government is very careful not to stray into that territory and to be clear on where we are able to support and give our opinion on things. But of course, it's any review or any work undertaken to review the structures of the parliamentary commissioners is absolutely up to the Parliament, and decisions should be taken in that regard. It's worth highlighting the work that the government has done round about understanding the need for new public sector bodies. The ministerial control framework that we put in place last year does precisely that. It's a robust structure that takes into account whether the new public sector body is required and assesses the financial implications of that to make sure that it will fulfil its objectives and isn't duplicating something that's already there. As I say, that framework is in place for bodies that are created by government, where that relates to a commissioner that's under the supported and sponsored by the SPCB. Then government seeks to engage with the SPCB at an early stage in that process, and clearly proposals that come from it out with government aren't included in that framework. As I said, it's very important that distinction between what is government supported bodies created through that mechanism is distinct from those that rightly lie within the guise of the Parliament. So I think that hopefully gives an outline. I'm very keen to, as I said, support the work that you're undertaking, and the government is very keen to work and support the SPCB in the work it's taking forward or may take forward in review of the commissioner landscape. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Minister. You've touched there really on the ministerial control framework, and you've made it clear basically how keen you are to improve efficiency and effectiveness, as you said in your opening statement. Now, the government itself is bringing forward a commissioner called the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. The Justice Committee don't seem very keen on it. And indeed, we had a couple of former MSPs who had been putting forward kind of a proposal of commissioners, one of whom was putting forward such a proposal and didn't really think it was a good idea anymore. So is that something, for example, that the government is looking at and maybe deciding not to take that forward?
I wouldn't be able to speak for the government on that. The new First Minister obviously will bring forward his programme for government. That's delayed until September, of course, because of the election period. And whether there is anything in that with regards to that proposal, I wouldn't be in a position to comment on that.
So would it be fair, though, to say that that's something that may be looked at?
I think that would be a question for First Minister as part of that PFG process.
I hope it's not going to be a morning, a ducking and diving.
No. Nor is it a morning where I'm going to come here and...
In the great scale of things, it's not going to be decisive on the 4th of July, you know what I mean? But, maybe I'm wrong in that, but you never know. Okay then, so one of the things that we've looked at this quite significantly, and last week we took evidence from the SPCB, and they seem to be of the view that they don't really have the remit or capacity to hold commissioners properly to account. And there was a feeling, I don't know if my colleagues share it, but I certainly felt it was quite palpable, of exasperation in the SPCB, that their responsibilities in terms of this area seem to be growing and they don't feel they've got the ability to do that justice. So where do you see the SPCB's role in this commissioner landscape?
I think it's first of all,
as we go forward.
Yeah, you've got to be clear where the distinction is between government and parliament, and you understand that obviously in the committee structure.
Indeed.
Better than anyone. So it's not government's role to say what commissioners there should or shouldn't be to review that.
No, but where do you think the SPCB should fit in?
Well, I think I heard the evidence from SPCB, and their position was that they are, rightly, they inherit, probably the wrong word, but parliament as a whole will decide whether there should be a commissioner or not. And then the SPCB will execute that function and channel the budget through to that commissioner. And through the committee structure, the commissioners are held to account. And as you well know, and when I was on committees, that's exactly what happened. Commissioners would come in periodically and be asked to account for the work that they were undertaking. And the relationship between the SPCB and the commissioners covers off as understand that a framework that enables that commissioners to be clear what the expectation of the parliament and its committees is. But I suppose SPCB is right, they don't create the commissioners, they're created by parliament as a whole.
Yeah, I mean, do you feel that the kind of, although commissioners can give evidence to committees, etc., do you feel the scrutiny there is robust enough? Do you feel that there can be enhancements, and if so, how could that be improved?
Enhancements of commissioners by parliamentary
enhancements
committees?
Enhancements of how the scrutiny function is undertaken of commissioners, sorry.
Well, as I said, it's not up to government to scrutinise and hold commissioners to account, for very good reasons, because their role is to monitor in many cases what the work of government is. So I think that distinction is very important. How Parliament chooses to scrutinise commissioners is obviously a job for Parliament and its committees, but I heard evidence on that, and there's clearly different perspectives on that, but I would expect Parliament and its committees to do their job and hold commissioners robustly to account.
I'm getting the feeling that you're of the view that government doesn't really have a lot to say in this, so I'm just wondering where you feel the government's role is exactly in terms of commissioners overall. I mean, you talked about ones that the government is putting forward, but in terms of others, you talked earlier on in your opening statement about it being really up to Parliament. So do you feel that government should have no role whatsoever in that, even as an encouragement or a discourage?
Well, I think there's a few different things there. In terms of the scrutiny role, then I think for government to wade in and say we want to hold commissioners to account is clearly not something that would be acceptable, and it's not something that government would want to do. And likewise, for government to say that there shouldn't be certain commissioners, that could be deemed as straying into that territory. When it comes to the creation of commissioners, I think that's a different issue, clearly, because government, well, it's Parliament that would pass any legislation that created new commissioners. Government obviously has a significant input into that, both in terms of the position it takes, and clearly, even in a minority parliament, the weight that it holds in terms of legislation being passed or not being passed through the parliament. So I think government absolutely does have a role to play in its assessment of whether new commissioners are required and how they fit into the broader public sector landscape. And I think that, as part of the work I'm taking forward on that broader public sector landscape, is key.
And does the government have a view on why organisations are bringing forward commissioners, you know, whether it's for older people, whether it's for folk with neurodiversity or whatever? Because it's been suggested to us that it's because of a systemic lack of service delivery, for example, or indeed that ministers are not giving enough attention to a specific area. And obviously that is, in a way, an indictment of government. So I'm just wondering if the government has a view on that.
Well, I think it was at Jackson Carlow that, or somebody that talked through the evolution of this through various stages over decades, through inquiries and other bodies that were set up and so on and so forth. And now we're in a position where many interest groups want to have a commissioner. I think that I can understand why an advocacy group, and I heard the evidence from Age Concerned Scotland on this, would want a commissioner for their specific interest, because it allows them to raise a profile and argue more effectively within government or up to government for advocating for a specific a specific interest group. So I can understand why they would want to do that. I think what's important, looking at the broader public sector bodies landscape, and government absolutely takes a lead on this, is to understand what that landscape should look like to be most cost effective and most efficient. And I think some basic principles there are you want to keep this as simple as possible. So proliferation of public sector bodies more broadly that have a duplication of function is not the most efficient way to do that.
So if someone comes forward with a suggestion for a commissioner, so for example, the people's one that's been suggested, as I've mentioned already, and they've said, well, we don't have a minister for older people, and we don't have a minister for older people even in a ministerial title. We feel perhaps that older people are not getting the attention they deserve and all this. Does the government look at that and say there's a gap? There's obviously an issue here, there's a gap to be closed. What's the government's response to that? I mean, I'm not saying whether they just, I will agree or disagree with the commissioner, but what is government doing looking at the reasons for a commissioner in a specific area being proposed? Do they say, we need to do something about this because, you know, there's obviously something that's not transpiring that perhaps should, that's causing enough momentum for people to drive forward with such a suggestion?
Well, again, I think you don't want to confuse effective service delivery with how good advocacy groups are at doing their job, right? Because that's what advocacy groups do. Their job is to, as you know,
of course,
raise the profile of the group that they represent. Of course, it is. That's and we expect them to do that, and it's right and proper that they do that. I think the issue about ministerial, and see, that's different from, is there a service delivery issue? I think that an efficient and effective, streamlined, and as I said earlier, as simple as possible, public sector body of landscape is the most effective and efficient way to deliver public services, full stop. I think that the fact that there isn't a specific advocacy group named in the ministerial job title, I think we can read too much into that. If you listed out what every minister was responsible for, we're all responsible for 10, 15, 20 different things. You're not going to put all of that in your job title because, frankly, it'd be unmanageable. So the job titles are rightly, I believe, fairly broad-reaching, and cover a range of areas. If you look on the government website, there's a much fuller list of all the things each minister is responsible for, which in most cases is a half a page or a page of things. So if people are saying who is the minister responsible for whatever, that information is on the government website, and you see that when correspondence comes to government on a specific issue, the unit responsible will take a view on which minister is to answer that based on where it falls in within responsibility. So I say just because something isn't listed in a ministerial job title doesn't mean that it isn't a big part of the way government approaches and considers different issues.
I think it's more perception than reality, but perception is obviously very important. I mean, I'm just wondering why the government decided to, for example, honour victims in this commission, because obviously the committee was against it, and one of the reasons they said was, well, there's already a lot of independent bodies in that area, you know, and they quoted a number of everything from the Inspector of Prisons to the Inspector of Constabulary, etc., etc., and they didn't really feel there was a gap to be closed. So why is the government suggesting commissioners in such situations?
Well, I wasn't a government minister at that point in time, and the understanding is that proposal came forward in advance of the ministerial control framework being in place to assess that. And as I say, the programme for government will come forward in September with regard to the work that government is proposing to take forward.
Okay, I'm going to open up the session now to colleagues around the table, and the first will be Michelle to follow by Liz.
Good morning, Mr. McGee. Thank you for attending today. You're the Minister for Public Finance, and I think everyone can agree that the constraints on public finance are deeply significant. And that is one of the key things that has been behind the driver for us looking at the commissioner landscape. So given your role as Minister for Public Finance, what leadership do you intend to set in the commissioner's landscape when you relate it to the issues around public finance?
Well, I think there's two points there. First of all, when you look at commissioners, and the committee's rightly looked at the cost of commissioners, which I think comes to about £18 million in total. When you consider that against the cost of the broader public sector landscape, clearly it's a very, 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 very small percentage of the total cost of the 130 or so public bodies that that government supports across the landscape. Most medium-sized public bodies on their own run up a bigger bill than the £18 million you're talking about for commissioners in total. So in that regard, absolutely, it's an issue, but it's very, very far from being where the main event is in terms of how we make the public sector landscape more efficient, and I know that's outside the scope of your considerations this morning. And then the second point is what we've talked about already. I think that a robust evaluation of the cost of new proposals for commissioners coming forward is important, and that is part of the ministerial control framework, and that's something that I'll be absolutely focused on as new proposals come forward, mm-hmm. to understand whether they make the landscape more efficient and effective or just add cost.
What did you make of the SPCB's consideration of costs? I think off the top of my head it was about 12%, given that, you know, it's top sliced off their budget and we don't have an estimate for if all the new proposed commissioners went through, but given it's roughly sort of double, you could say then that it takes it up to 24% of their entire budget. What reflections would you have on that? Do you think that that is A, acceptable, or B, sustainable?
Well, again, you've got to look at this in a broader context. The Scottish Parliament budget of around about £140 million comes from government, so you're talking about a percentage of that number, but that's in the context of a broader Scottish Government budget of, depending on how you count it, £47 billion or £62 billion if you include all the non-cash and other items in that regard. So again, it's a very, very small percentage of the total budget. In terms of how the Scottish Parliament see that, I heard their evidence. When a new commissioner is created, their conversation with government through that budget process will be, we've now got a new commissioner, therefore we need another, whatever it's, £500 million to support that commissioner, and that'll be part of the discussion with government in order to fund the Parliament. So that funding should flow from government to Parliament and on to the commissioner to support that, would be the way that would normally work.
Okay, right.
So it's not, the point I'm making is it's not that Parliament's having to do less things of other things because they've got a commissioner they need to find space for. That money should flow through to them from government.
So I suppose what I'm hearing is you sound really quite relaxed about the current commissioner landscape. Is that true? And are you equally relaxed about the proposals for extension?
Not at all. My focus, as you would expect, is on where we save hundreds of millions. And frankly, you could shut down all the commissioners tomorrow and it would save you £18 million. So it's a drop in the ocean in terms of the task ahead of us, in terms of assessing efficiency across the wider public sector landscape. That doesn't mean it's not something, as I said, that think is important. And as I said already, the robust controls in place for review of new proposals coming forward is something I'll be taking very seriously to address and challenge through the ministerial control framework, where whether there's a need for new commissioners or not.
So then, what do you attribute the cultural underpinning? Now, I don't have the exact quote in front of me, but we had one former MSP who had originally proposed a commission and then gave evidence to us who was less enthusiastic than they were at the outset when they were proposing it, and perhaps kind of outlined that it was a sense of activity to give the illusion of progress. This talks to me of a culture of be seen to be doing rather than a relentless focus on outcomes. So what are your reflections on the culture of creation of commissioners, perhaps reflecting on the numerous public bodies we've got?
Well, I think both you and I have got experience of seeing this in other large organisations in our earlier careers, and I think it's fair to say that there's always a risk that the seeking to make organisational change to create the illusion of progress is something that people fall into willingly, wittingly or unwittingly. That's, I think, par for the course, so it's always something you need to be conscious of. Because people, for good reasons, will think they're doing the right thing by giving highlight to an issue that they think is a very important issue. And one way they can do that I'm self-evidently is to propose and create a commissioner to do that. But the question then is, does that deliver most effectively both for that group and across the broader system? And it goes back to what I said earlier, you want the organisational structures in terms of the landscape of public sector bodies to be as simple as possible. Keep it simple is a very effective principle. As simple as possible with as few moving parts as possible, because that's how you get the most cost-effective solution, but also, frankly, the most effective solution in terms of delivery, because people aren't falling over each other when they're trying to do their job, and it's much clearer who's responsible for what and whether they have or haven't delivered.
And do you think that, in effect, to try and get to the point where there can be any change in this area is akin to a circular firing squad? You know, you could say, well, government, well, we don't want to be seen to be interviewing in this. SPCB made their views clear last week. It's Parliament's role. Members will continue to advocate. And the net effect, when you consider overcoming the very significant blockers from vested interests, politicians, civil servants, internal government and media, do you think the net effect will there'll be no change and we'll carry on doing what we've always done and get what we've always got?
Well, again, talking in the broader public sector landscape, I would very much hope not. And my role is to make sure that we do drive change and make things more efficient and effective, for free up more money for the front line, from back office, simplify the landscape, make it clearer who's responsible for what, and deliver better public services for the people of Scotland as a consequence of that. And again, going back to the commissioner landscape as a small subset of that, it's not government's role, as I said, to interfere in a review and conduct a review of the commissioner landscape per se, but government absolutely has a role to play in taking a view on whether new commissioners come forward and how they support or otherwise the broader ecosystem.
And just finishing off then, in terms of our final report, how interested will you be in its findings?
I think it'll be I'll be very interested to see what you say. I think it could well be a very effective or helpful piece of evidence in support of broader work that we're taking forward in terms of setting the tone around about where the public sector landscape needs to go.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Liz, to be followed by John.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. Just following up on the line of questioning from Michelle Thompson, when we had Professor Page and Dr. Elliott in front of us 2 weeks ago, they were both recommending a root and branch review of the whole thing, the whole structure. If Parliament was, if this committee recommended that and Parliament was to agree, do you think the Scottish Government would be supportive of that?
Absolutely. I think what's important is that government isn't seen to be telling Parliament what to do on this, but if Parliament wants to decide that's what they want to do, government absolutely be supportive of that, be that in terms of information or processes, for example, the ministerial control framework or other insights or whatever, very happy to do that. But I think that would apply effectively to the seven commissioners as it stands at the moment, is effectively with the scope of that and any potential new ones that are coming down the track.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is the interesting point, because of the existing commissioners that we have, I think you referenced this earlier in your opening remarks, there has been perhaps a piecemeal approach to the development that's evolved over time. Whereas currently, what we have, the recommendations for new commissioners, are largely those that are on the advocacy side of things. And that's why we've obviously had complaints about the fact that the reason for the advocacy might be because public sector services are failing. So the question that I have for you is, do you think that the existing commissioner structure, never mind the proposals we've got just now, do you think the existing commissioner structure has been effective in terms of delivering why they are there?
If you look at the existing commissioner structure, and again, the committee's unpicked this through your evidence sessions, there's different roles that are fulfilled within there. So clearly the Ombudsman, which is almost half of the, it's almost as big as everything else put together in terms of the commission landscape, everyone knows what the Ombudsman is, everyone knows what they do, and you meet constituents all the time that have used the Ombudsman. So I think you can, it's up to the committee to take a view on how effective that's been, but certainly it's got profile and does a well-recognised job. You've then got the Information Commissioner and the Ethical Standards Commissioner, who, again, I would say have a very effective role, clearly, absolutely independent of government for very, very good reasons, in terms of how they monitor and provide processes for those issues around about information management, transparency and ethics to be managed. So I think that they provide that important role as well. And you can go through the rest of the seven that are there to see what the perspective is on how effective they are. But I think the important point, I think, that's behind the question is we need more commissioners because groups feel that more advocacy needs to be done on their behalf. I think that's very different to the role, clearly, that the commissions have mentioned already, which are the biggest part of the commissioner landscape, the very important role that they play, which is clearly very different from public service delivery or an advocacy role. And again, I think it comes back to advocacy job groups probably wouldn't be in their job, doing their job properly if they weren't asking for a commissioner. So the fact that they're asking for one isn't necessarily something that, alongside all the other things that the advocate for, isn't necessarily an indication that things are failing, okay. I would say.
That's interesting about those commissioners that have a regulatory or a complaints basis and inquiry on that level. What is your view on the commissioners, for example, the Children and Young People's Commissioner, generally speaking, well supported by parties across the Parliament. But if it comes to the measurement of the achievements, if you look at child poverty, if you look at attainment, if you look at a whole lot of the issues where we're trying to improve the lives of children, you could argue that that's not been desperately successful. And I just wonder what the Scottish Government has a view on in terms of how do you measure the effectiveness of commissioners that are based on advocacy and trying to improve human rights and giving a voice to those who are more disadvantaged?
Well, again, everyone's going to be different. And I think it's I watched with interest the evidence session on that. And I don't think, I think you made those points, and from memory, I don't think there was any witnesses that were able to say, well, they've delivered X, Y, and Z. I think that the counterfactual is always important, but very difficult to put a finger on in these regards. So would things have been worse if the Commission hadn't been in place?
Do you think that's a problem in that the evidence to support whether they have been efficient and well-run and effective in delivering their outcomes, do you think it's a problem that evidence is really very hard to find?
Yeah, as I say, but I think the counterfactual is important, and if part of what they see their role is to change perceptions and change priorities, then you could argue that an advocacy role, that's what you're trying to deliver. You're not necessarily trying to deliver on service. But you could also look at it and say, in terms of child poverty, clearly Scotland's in a significantly better place than the rest of the UK in that regard, so you could argue that there is evidence there that supports that. Well, they'd attribute that to the Church Commissioner or not is obviously a matter for the debate and a matter for the relevant committee to dig into in more detail.
Were you surprised when, I think 3 weeks ago, we received evidence from the existing commissioner who said that he hadn't been called in front of a committee despite having produced seven different reports? He hadn't actually been in front of a committee more than once. Did that surprise you?
Well, I'll be careful what I say. It surprised me, but as I say at the outset, it's absolutely not government's job to tell committees.
No, I'm just asking
who they should bring in and what they should ask.
Can you reflect on that, though? Can you reflect on that? Because it's we felt as a committee that that was surprising and maybe a problem, and therefore that the problem might be that the scrutiny of the work that commissioners are doing is not sufficiently good in terms of parliamentary oversight. Would you reflect on that?
I certainly reflect on it, but I see a number of things there. First of all, clearly I think every commissioner and every committee is going to take perhaps a different perspective on this or a different approach on it. Certainly when I've been on committees and we've had evidence sessions with the relevant commissioners, I felt that those were robust and to the point and effective and got to the number of the issue. If other commissioners feel that that's not the case, then that's a matter for the relevant committee and the parliamentary bodies as a whole to perhaps address that. I think, again, I was looking at this from the outside, because absolutely it's not government's role to tell committees who they should ask what questions of. You would hope, and certainly it's everybody's interests, that committees are being thorough in their evaluation. Yeah. And
so could you also reflect on the fact that perhaps the accountability level by Parliament isn't sufficient when it comes to ensuring that commissioners are doing their job properly? Could you reflect on that?
Well, I mean, that would primarily come through the committee structure. So I think it talks to the same answer I've given, which is that Parliament, through its structures, which in the question of bringing somebody in and taking evidence from them, would happen in a committee structure. Parliament and parliamentary committees, it's in everybody's interest if they're doing that as effectively as possible.
OK, thank you, Convener.
Thank you, John, to follow by Michael.
Thanks, Convener. Maybe to follow on from some of my colleagues. I mean, you've stressed already that clearly it's for the Parliament to decide about new commissioners, and the government will have a voice in that, but just one voice amongst others.
Could you just restate that again to make sure you picked it up correctly?
Opening comment, yeah. But yes, I mean,
in terms of new commissioners.
If the Parliament's looking at a new commissioner, then the government will give its view and everyone else will give their view. Whereas if it's the government proposing a new commissioner, obviously it's primarily the government that will drive that.
I think even in a case where it's not the government's got a significant input to that. Because at the end of the day, government, through Parliament, even as I said, even in a minority Parliament, holds sway over whether or not a bill would go through Parliament, obviously.
OK, no, I accept all of that. And you also stressed the independence of SPCB bodies. Mm. Do you think they're more independent than government commissioners or whatever? I mean, we've got the Inspector of Constabulary, mm-hmm. Inspector of Prisons, people like that. I think they're seen as quite independent. Mm-hmm. From the public's point of view, is there a difference?
It's a good question. When you look at the landscape, there are a wide range of different bodies. And the Auditor General is another one who's obviously very independent of government, and rightly so, and adds a lot of value because of that. So there are bodies that aren't SPCB bodies that are very much seen as being independent and fulfil their functions very effectively as a consequence of that. And there are bodies that are, obviously the commissioners we're talking about, that are SPCB. So I think that that's a structure that's obviously grown up over time. It's not as if that's been sat down and designed from the get-go as to this is the way this will work, and these bodies will all be Parliament bodies, these bodies will all be not Parliament bodies, effectively.
I mean, one of our witnesses said it's independence of thought that matters most, more than whether they're a government body or a Parliament body or something else.
Well, I think there's probably more to it than that. That's part of it, and that's an essential part of it, obviously. But and again, I'm not an expert on the legislation that's set up the Auditor General and other bodies. Clearly, the way that they're set up and their remit is important in terms of the legislative competence they've got to address issues is an important part of that as well.
And the ones that have been set up by the government or are currently under the government, I mean, are they scrutinised? Can you say anything about how within government, within the civil service, they are scrutinised?
That's a good question. I mean, my experience in government up to now has primarily been obviously in the economic space, so I know how we work with economic agencies, but that's of a very, very different relationship. So I don't know if officials have got any specific comments on how government formally engages in terms of monitoring those independent bodies that are under the government remit, if that makes sense.
There's not a formal sponsorship role, as there would be for other types of public body. Obviously, it's SPCB who look after those bodies. I mean, there'll be an engagement on a policy level, but not a formal review function. But we can take that away and provide more information on specific cases, if that would be helpful.
So just to be clear, I wasn't thinking primarily of the SPC bodies. I was thinking of like the Inspector of Constabulary or the Inspector of Prisons. Is it just on a policy level that they get reviewed?
I wouldn't be able to speak to those functions. I don't know, Kat, if you've got anything else.
No, I would have to write to the committee and let you know about that. I haven't been closely involved in that. My remit is around public bodies themselves, which is slightly different.
Okay. I mean, if we take something like the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which is more in our space, I mean, the committee meets them regularly. I think the OECD is going to be doing a review of them. And can you say anything about what's the, you know, does it, again, does the government review the SFC at all?
My understanding, again, I think we maybe want to just take some more information from those that do the work in this space in government directly. But clearly the role of the Scottish Fiscal Commission is hugely important, that is independent of government. The extent to which, and it's been reinforced, the extent to which their budgeting process is assessed and the interaction directly with government in terms of their operational efficiency, there will absolutely be, that will be part of a conversation, but clearly drawing the line between that and their independence in terms of the way they carry out their function is hugely important. But it's an interesting point, and I think I'd be happy to explore that further and come back with more specifics.
Okay. I mean, you've come across as fairly relaxed about, you know, a few more commissioners. And
I don't think I have, but I'll come back to that.
Okay, well, sorry. more relaxed than I am, anyway. But I fully take the point, which everyone's made, that Parliament has to decide on a case-by-case basis. But, I mean, you know, the question is, where are we going in the longer term? And, I mean, if we end... And you, I mean, another point you made was that actually the money saved in abolishing even all the commissioners or in one commissioner is not that huge, which, again, I agree with. But, I mean, if we got to, say, 50 commissioners, you know, if it really seriously got a lot bigger. I mean, I did ask the previous First Minister if we got to 100, would he be worried? And he kind of agreed that he would be worried if it got to 100. But I'll try 50 then. I mean, would you be worried? Would you be worried if we got to 50 commissioners?
I think worried is probably not the word I would use. I think I've been very, very clear. And the third time I said this, that my perspective on this with the responsibility I've got is to very robustly assess the need for any future commissioners and what they add to the landscape. Are they adding more clutter? Are they adding more cost? Are they adding more confusion? Or are they a role that needs to be carried out because nobody else has carried it out? And it's an important role that needs to be carried out, and is it value for money? So that process, rest assured, is something that I will be carried out to make sure that we do that as effectively as possible. I think the use of the word worried is perhaps, and I don't lie awake at night worrying about how many commissioners there are. And I think it comes back to the point. I mean, take your ridiculous example. You know, we had another 50 commissioners and they all cost the same as the average of the smaller commissioners we've got in place at the moment. That would come to roughly the same cost as an average size body, public body, of which we have about 130. So you've got to consider this in context. So the answer is, I'm looking to save hundreds of millions of pounds. I'm obviously going to look at where the big money is, not where the small money is. Yes. That doesn't mean that this isn't important, but it does mean that I wouldn't be doing my job properly if I spent all my time worrying about £500,000 for a new commissioner when I should be worrying about £500 million on back office costs somewhere else.
I do get that, but I mean, I was taken by your phrase, set the tone, and I think that's a good phrase.
Yeah.
And if, you know, there's a kind of public statement that commissioners are going to be restricted, let's say, that kind of sends out a message to the wider. Now, one of the suggestions that we've had from a number of witnesses was that the SHRC could be strengthened and expanded. So rather than having lots of separate commissioners, the Scottish Human Rights Commission could be given a bit more clout, could look at individual cases, and then maybe a system like I think the UN has with rapporteurs so that people would report, and maybe for a few years they would concentrate on children, a few years concentrate on older people. So it would give a bit more one organisation with all of this within it. Have you any thoughts on that?
So again, this is going to get very boring, but I'm going to preface this by saying that it's not government's job to tell parliamentary bodies how to organise themselves. But that model is an interesting model. I think it's a model that's probably proved to be effective elsewhere. And certainly if you're looking at this in the abstract from organisational design principles, and this ecosystem or anywhere else, you would be looking, of course, to leverage existing bodies that are able to take functioning effectively to be able to take responsibility for other pieces of work. Of course, you would do that as a first step. And the principles round about the ministerial control framework talk very much to that. Is there an existing body that can carry out the functions that you're asking this new body to carry out?
I mean, related to that, you know, the question has been who is going to lead on all this, who's going to take all of this forward if we're changing it. And you seem to be indicating that the government would not lead on, say, we went down that route of giving the SHRC more clout. So, I mean, who should be leading on it? I mean, it's easy to say Parliament, but Parliament's 129 of us and we're all looking in different directions. I mean, do you think it's the Finance Committee that needs to drive this forward?
I think, again, if you parse this out, the public sector reform piece, the government bodies, absolutely, we are responsible for that, and myself as Minister leading that. The creation of new commissioners, where I think a lot of the perhaps concern is, the government has a significant role to play because, frankly, in most cases, they don't go through Parliament unless government, at least, is not opposed to them. So government has absolutely a role to take a perspective and a view on that side of it. I think when you get into the territory of what we do with the seven existing commissioners, if a review is to be carried out of that, then government would be, as I said, supportive of that, but it wouldn't be our role. I see it wouldn't be helpful for government to be involved in that review, because the parliamentary bodies, and it may be that this committee is the best place to take that forward.
Well, finally, I mean, it may be, or is it?
Well, it's up to Parliament to decide, but I think, I mean, I'm not going to tell the convener how to run his committee, but I think if the committee decided they want to do that, then government would absolutely be very supportive of that step.
I mean, to put it the other way, is there someone in the Parliament better than this committee who could lead on that?
Well, I'm not an expert in Parliament structure. I think the SPCB were of the view that their job was to execute on what they're, frankly, told to execute on by Parliament, which I can understand that position. So, again, I think this committee and the SPCB and other parliamentary bodies, we need to kind of work that out between you. But there's a number of ways you could do that.
OK, thanks, Convener.
Interesting. OK, Michael, to be followed by Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for the evidence so far, Minister. Can I ask, what is the threshold of public finance that would command your attention?
Well, all of this is important. Of course it is. And I think you clearly understand this as well. If you're faced with a series of problems and we've got a job to do to figure out how we save money across that, clearly you give more attention to the areas where you're going to save the most money. I think it'd be ridiculous not to do that, and nobody would expect you to do that. Nobody would thank you for saving £1 million when you could have saved hundreds of millions of pounds.
I'm interested, though, in terms of one of the biggest areas at the moment, we talk about ferries. I mean, you said, you know, you can send yourself £500 million rather than maybe the £18 million we're here. I mean, is that not part of the attitude that then results in the fact that the bill
spirals from
50 million to 400 million?
No, absolutely not, because that's all of those areas where we are spending money, of course, need to be addressed to make sure that money is spent most effectively. And I think it's you can argue with it, the fact that you would want to focus more on understanding and addressing the challenges where you've got more potential to save more money. Of course you would.
Okay.
Now, I think the question of tone is important. And hopefully what I've said this morning around about this and the broader landscape and the commissioners helped to set that tone. Frankly, I think the ministerial control framework, even just being in place, has helped to set a tone more broadly around about people not coming forward with public bodies or commissioners that they otherwise have done.
Okay, thank you. What is the government and your own understanding about the role? What is the role of the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body?
In my perspective?
Yeah. What does it do?
Well, I mean, its role is to manage the Parliament and ensure the smooth and effective functioning of Parliament and the tasks that the Parliament as a whole was asked to carry out, be that commissioners or other roles are asked to do.
Because when it was first devised, we had this evidence to the committee. It certainly wasn't, certainly not in its broad terms of reference, to manage these multiple different organisations look and scrutinise their, and they've got, we believe, 1.4 members of staff to undertake the work of looking at the budgets. I mean, that's not, they've not got the capacity to do the work that, in essence, you, as the government, have asked them to do.
Well, the government's asked them, Parliament's asked them to do it.
Well, I mean, it's a fine distinction, Minister. I mean, you mentioned that Parliament's passed a vote, but, you know, so some of these commissioners were certainly passed when the SNP had majority.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it's the legislation that's gone through under your government, something you've asked them to do, but they don't have the capacity to do the thing they've asked them to do, do they?
The capacity, the Parliament's got a budget of north of £140 million. So, well, I don't know how many staff there are, but it's got resources. Now,
so
if the Parliament's in a position
more
where,
of that money on this,
well,
rather
if
than,
the Parliament, as I say, has a conversation with the government every year in terms of how much they think their budget should be, and that's where that conversation would take place if Parliament feels that it's got more responsibilities and needs a higher budget as a consequence of that. Clearly, it's got to take place in the broader fiscal situation, but there's absolute scope for that conversation to take place.
I suppose it just kind of feels a little bit like this is where difficult things are parked. So that we don't know. So, for instance, last week we had an amendment from the government that came forward on the issue of the Michael Matheson's iPad bill. It said it was passed by Parliament, but brought forward by the Deputy First Minister. And it finished with calls on the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body to initiate an independent review of the Parliament's complaints process to restore integrity and confidence in the Parliament and its procedures. That's not anywhere near within the terms of reference of the corporate body, is it?
Well, who would you want to carry out a review of those parliamentary procedures?
Well, was to be fair, Minister, it wasn't my amendment.
No, I understand
wasn't
that, right?
Asking but to do, and
the point I'm making
asking
is
for anybody to carry it out. So it's what I'm probing towards, and I think is the purpose of the understanding of what the corporate body does. We've got really significant concerns from members of the corporate body who've come in front of us, both in terms of the capacity they have, but the locus they have to undertake these roles appropriately. They don't have the capacity to do it. And it just seems to me that within this commissioner side of it, it's, you know, we don't really know where to put this. You know, it'll go there. And the SPCB, and then it's growing like Topsy. And they don't have the capacity to do it.
I think you need to look at the situation of the broader public sector bodies landscape. Okay, now, there are, as I said, 130-odd public bodies there. The budget that they go through and the staff they employ and the responsibilities they've got is far, 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 far in excess of what the commissioners are doing. So I think the idea that everything's getting dumped on the commissioners is very far from the truth in terms of.
I'm just saying there's a few things that have been difficult for the government that they've parked in this place, and it doesn't seem to me that.
I don't accept. I think that you look at that through their lens. You see, if government was marking its own homework on some of this stuff, you'd be rightly more upset. So I think Parliament has a role to play here, absolutely. And as I said, there was a conversation about resourcing. There's a place for that conversation to take place.
So on that point, kind of Parliament marking its own homework. So we had, and Liz Smith referenced that already, we had evidence from one of the commissioners who said that he had produced 7 reports to Parliament, 2 annual reports and accounts, 1 operational report, a code of practice, and 3 separate assurance reviews. And that commissioner has been called to committee once. I think you've already expressed that you don't think that that's particularly satisfactory. What do you think the Justice Committee shouldn't have done to allow them to see the Commissioner more?
Well, again, it's not up to me to tell committees or the Parliament how to run their affairs. Okay, I'm just from the outside.
But it was your government who established the Commissioner, wasn't it?
So, Biometrics Commissioner. Are you saying that you don't think there's a need for the Commissioner?
No, that's absolutely not what I'm saying.
Okay.
Are you saying that it shouldn't be
the committees that should.
I'm asking the question in terms of whether you as a government think that the scrutiny process you've put in to enable the legislation that you brought forward and passed as a government is effective, and whether the Parliament has
the
capacity to do it.
Process. I mean, it's up to committees review and scrutinise the work of the commissioners, as you do a whole range of things, including the work, rightly, of government. So, again, it's not, I think, up to government to say that we should, how committees should scrutinise and carry out that work. And if the commissioner feels that the SPCB sponsored commissioner feels that the Parliament and its committees haven't scrutinised his work effectively, then again, that's a conversation to bring to the attention of the Parliament. And
there must be a limit, the government must see a limit to that point, though, where they say we can't just continue to bestow functions and responsibilities upon a limited body and ask them to continue undertaking
that.
Well,
as I say, it's not a limited body. We already talked through the budget process, and in the case of these commissioners, another £500,000, that will be part of the conversation round about how much of an increase in its £140 million budget does the Parliament need to support that and carry out that function.
And there are seven commissioners.
Right.
Do you think the Parliament should have a higher budget then?
Well, I think in a case where a new commissioner is created, clearly that budget would be passed through the Parliament.
But at the moment, the Parliament is saying that it doesn't have the capacity to scrutinise the existing commissioners. So you think there should be more MSPs to do that work?
No, that's not what I said either. You've got a scrutiny job to do, and that's the Parliament that carries that out through its committees. There's a budget there to carry out that work. The SPCB, one of its roles is to make sure that that's managed effectively and efficiently to deliver on what it's been asked to do. It's Parliament asks it to do that. You could make the same case for any one of the other public sector bodies we've got right across the landscape who are asked to do things, and they've got a budget and in many cases a reducing budget, and they're asked to deliver similar services, but that's what efficient government is about.
Can I ask, what's the current position of the government on a presumption against new public bodies?
Well, as I said, we've got the ministerial control framework in place. Any public body that is proposed would go through that process and a robust assessment of why we need that public body. So I think the presumption absolutely is there's no more public bodies to be created.
Unless we need them.
Unless it's a very, very strong case. Right.
Okay. And on your...
And frankly, I would say that we would want to look at scope for having fewer public bodies.
Okay. And you've said that you would welcome the government would welcome a broader discussion about a parliamentary review of commissioners in the broadest terms. Would the government pause the creation of further commissioners pending a review?
I think that would be an interesting conversation. I think that, as I've said already several times, my role as the Minister for Public Sector Reform is to... One of the roles I'll be taking forward is to, through the ministerial control framework, assess very robustly the need for any new commissioners and with a view to understanding whether it's absolutely necessary or not. Now, clearly, I don't want to make a commitment because if it's part of legislation that's moving forward and there's a bill going through, and this is a hypothetical scenario that does a lot of other things, and a commissioner is part of that, and everybody agrees we need a commissioner to do that, then clearly... That's a specific situation, and you wouldn't want to stop a whole legislative programme on the back of waiting for a review. But I think in principle, the concept of no new public bodies, the concept of robustly assessing any proposals that come forward is something I absolutely adhere to and very welcome any review from the committee in that regard.
And you've validated, said that it's the right thing for lobbyists and people advocates to advocate for a new commissioner. Isn't it the role of government to say no?
Yes, it is.
Okay, thank you.
Of course it is.
Thank you, Jamie.
Thanks. Morning to the Minister and colleagues. Just on some of the points that Michael Mara just raised there. I mean, do you feel that it is the responsibility of government to ensure that when government has led or set up a new commissioner, do you believe it's the responsibility of government to ensure that proper scrutiny can take place of that commissioner and their roles?
Well, clearly scrutiny is an important part of the work that commissioner would do. The Parliament would carry out that scrutiny if it's an SPCB body created under the sponsorship of the Parliament, and it's right that that is where it's done. And as I said, the resourcing conversation, like with every other public body and everywhere else that government spends its money on, is something that happens through the budgeting process, and the Parliament would make its case and there'd be a conversation there.
But I mean, we've heard a number of times that the scrutiny it isn't there or it differs between different commissioners. So if the Scottish Government is setting up a commissioner, Surely it is a responsibility or an interest of Scottish Government to ensure that that scrutiny is in place. Is that, do you believe that's happening at the moment? Or is it a question of, we, you know, Scottish Government sets up the Commissioner, it's up to somebody else to ensure that it's, that role is scrutinised?
Well, I think like everything else that happens in the legislative programme, legislation is passed that creates some, be it a commissioner or some other piece of work that needs to happen, and through the financial memorandum as part of that process, that's considered, that's scrutinised through the parliamentary processes, and then Parliament as a whole takes a view on that. Government's clearly got a significant influence on that, depending on what it is, and then there's a budget process where the assessment on what resources are required and what parts of the public sector landscape is assessed to understand what resources bodies need to carry out the functions that are asked of them, and that's an ongoing process, obviously.
Does the Scottish Government undertake any evaluation of the commissioners, any evaluation of outcomes, value for money, etc., including those commissioners that have not been set up by the government?
Well, in terms of ones that haven't been set up, then clearly there isn't anything to evaluate other than what the proposal is and what the financial memorandum and what the expectation is.
I mean ongoing after they've been set
but
up.
But ones that have been set up, as I say, it's not government's role to stray into that territory of saying that what our view, or for us to scrutinise the work of bodies that are set up and are sponsored by the Parliament and the SPCB.
So once a commission is set up by Scottish Government, there's no evaluation, no scrutiny by government whatsoever?
And the SPCB and the committee structure.
And you have no concerns or opinion of whether that's happening or taking place, or checks on whether that's actually taking place? Given, as I say, that we've been, you know, we've heard from a number of different areas that perhaps the scrutiny process, it differs from commissioner to commissioner.
So you ask me, is government concerned in a scenario where parliamentary committees aren't doing their job? Again, I think if you're in a situation where that was having a material impact on public service delivery, then clearly government's got an issue. But I think we need to be, again, careful of government straying into that space. I mean, if you take the example of, frankly, any of the work that those existing commissioners are doing, it's important that government, because of the work that they carry out, holding government to account in many regards, it's important that government isn't seen to be stepping into that space and acting as the scrutineer of those bodies, nor indeed to be saying that we don't think you've been scrutinised correctly or effectively. That, and that's rightly Parliament's job. And I think if we were saying the opposite, you would rightly be not happy about that.
Should there be obviously more commissioners, and there are some in the pipeline? I'm not necessarily talking about John Mason's nightmare scenario of 50 commissioners, which I think you recognise how that was received on by the committee. But should the Scottish Government be looking forward to looking forward to new commissioners in certain areas over the future, particularly on the regulatory side? Do you not think? Do you not think that actually putting forward those proposals, the ability for them those roles to be scrutinised and their outcomes to be evaluated, is a key part of that? And could you be confident that it's happening, or is it just a question of, well, it's not, once we've created them, it's not our responsibility any longer, it's for the Parliament?
It's again that important the distinction of where that responsibility lies and what government is, because if those bodies are there in part to scrutinise the work of government, for government then to take responsibility for scrutinising those bodies, I think we end up in a place that,
it's not a question of the government scrutinising. It's the government ensuring that bodies that they've set up are properly, that there is a process for them to be properly scrutinised and an evaluation of outcomes. And what seems to be for commissioners across the board at the moment is that isn't happening. And obviously government has a key role in this in terms of setting up commissioners in certain areas. But do you not think that's a concern, that you can create a commissioner, but actually there may not be that?
Well, I think we would expect the Parliament and its committees to be able to do their job.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was just briefly kind of on the point, again, that Michael Marra was talking about in terms of the costs. I mean, I recognise what you're saying about £18 million not being a huge amount of money. Part of the problem, of course, is that actually when particularly projects get out of hand, it's not huge amounts of money straight off, it's incremental increases. It's the ferries going up by 12 million, 15 million, etc. And again, not wanting to bring in the 50 commissioner threat, but you know, do you not feel that if we're not careful now, this whole area could get out of hand?
I've already said four times, and I'll say it for the fifth time, we have been very robust about the ministerial control framework and government's position on the creation of new public bodies in general, and that extends to new commissioners. So this isn't something that we're not very conscious of, isn't something that we are not taking steps on, it isn't something that we're robustly taking a position on. Certainly in my new role, that's my absolute intention. So it's not something we're ignoring. I'm just making the point that there's a bigger landscape out there that's also very much in focus and being looked at, where there are much larger sums of money to be saved.
I do appreciate that, and I mean, I think it's right that there is a focus on the pounds, but you know, the pennies add up as well.
I'm not saying they don't, and I'm not saying that we're not doing that, and I'm not saying that we're not robustly assessing proposals as they come forward, and I'm not saying that the Parliament shouldn't be looking and reviewing at existing commissioners and whether they're getting value for money, and I'm not saying government won't support that. We very much look forward to supporting that work.
Okay, thanks.
Many a mickle makes a muckle, Minister. You've talked on a number of occasions, actually, about the robustness of the government in terms of assessing new commissioners, but I'm wondering why, therefore, we're still progressing, not just with the Victims and Witnesses Commissioner, but a proposed Future Generations Commissioner and a Disability Commissioner. How do they fit in the context of the ministerial control framework?
The proposals for those commissioners have still to go through the ministerial control framework.
Right, okay. So they may not transpire.
The proposals for those commissioners have still to go through the ministerial control framework.
Okay. One of the issues, of course, is that not everyone who advocates necessarily wants a commissioner. So I talked earlier on about, for example, there's a push for an older persons commissioner, but at the same time we also heard evidence that in actual fact some organisations who operate in that space feel that that money would be better spent on frontline services. Is that an assessment that the government makes when it decides to take forward commissioners or not, as the case may be?
And broadly across the public sector landscape, yeah, of course it is. An assessment of whether you're better spending this money on creating a new public body or a new commissioner versus are you better spending that money on frontline services is hugely important. And I would take it further, I would say that the work we're taking forward at the moment is to understand that we already spend too much money on back office functions compared to how much goes to the frontline. That's very much the direction of travel.
Okay, that's interesting, because I mean, it seems to me that, you know, you, instead of an organisation advocating directly with ministers or the Parliament, it basically then advocates through a commissioner who then advocates on their behalf. I mean, effectively, if you're having some of these advocacy commissioners, basically it's just adding a middle man, so to speak, to the process. Is that a fair assessment?
Well, again, you need to talk to advocacy groups about how they see that, but I suspect...
Well, some do actually take that view.
Yeah, perhaps, right, and some may see it as a method of amplification of their message. But
how do you see it? Do you see it as a way of, well, we'll talk to the commissioner about this rather than talk to 10 different groups out there? Is that, how does the government...
I think government, depending clearly on the portfolio, would always seek to take a view from the people, that the organisations that can reflect the view of different stakeholders. Of course we do. And certainly my experience in the economy space, you talk to a lot of different organisations all the time.
And if they're commissioners are seen to have greater responsibility, there was also evidence given to us that they feel that undermines democratic accountability, because rather than a minister who seems directly responsible, it's, well, that's really the role of the commissioner. It's almost a way for the government, as is perceived by some organisations, to body swerve responsibility. Do you think that's a fair assessment at all?
I don't think that's the case. I think that... the process of holding ministers and government to account and scrutiny through the parliamentary processes and elsewhere is obviously hugely important. I don't think that is a method for diverting that scrutiny. I don't see that at all.
Okay, and I mean, we've talked a lot about scrutiny, obviously, and one of the things which I haven't really talked to directly is sunset clauses. I mean, For example, it's been suggested that post-implementation reviews should be carried out along with periodic reviews to assess whether the office holder is still relevant and required. So it's not just about scrutiny on a day-to-day basis, but do we actually still need a given commissioner? You know, they might be set up with a kind of a bit of verve and, you know, a bit of passion, and let's get all these things done, and then 10, 20 years pass by and it seems to be just kind of plodding along, or even after 5 years. So where is the kind of end game, so to speak, in terms of these commissioners? Because once they're established, they just seem to be with us on a kind of permanent basis. That seems to certainly be the situation so far. And if that is not to be the case, there could be sunset clauses obviously brought in for new commissioners. But what about existing commissioners? Is there going to be any reviews to look at whether or not they should continue indefinitely?
Well, I think on the seven existing commissioners, it comes back to the conversation we've had. It's not the government's role to decide that we're going to close down certain commissioners. I think people would rightly have concerns about government stepping into the parliamentary space and saying that certain commissioners are no longer required and we're going to discontinue them. That review, I think, rightly should be carried out by the parliamentary authorities. But as I said, in terms of new commissioners being created, there's the process for assessing whether they're required or not. And I think that the mechanism of a sunset clause is something that absolutely could be part of the toolkit in a case where everybody agrees that a commissioner is required for whatever that may be, and it passes through the control framework and other assessment processes, that having a sunset clause in there may be quite a valuable and helpful mechanism to guard against exactly what you're describing.
Okay, one final question, and that's one of our predecessor committees way back in 2007 said, and I quote, policy papers accompanying new proposals for office holders should provide strong evidence that a proposer has explored all possible opportunities to have an existing body carry out the additional function or make use of existing resources wherever possible to support any new office holder and have very good reasons for not adopting an approach which would avoid the creation of a new body. And the committee further highlighted that the Scottish Commissioner for Children and Young People is an anomalous position that wouldn't actually have fulfilled that criteria had it been set up any time since 2007. But of course that commissioner is still in existence 17 years later. So I'm just wondering whether those criteria set out by a predecessor committee forms part of the ministerial control framework.
Yeah, and I've got the MCF here in front of me, or certainly extracts from it, and the criteria to be considered are, can the function or service not be carried out by an existing body, whether within Scottish Government Executive Agency or any other type of public body already established, and it goes on in similar vein through a series of questions.
And will that be applied to existing bodies to look at whether or not we still require them?
Well, it's existing public bodies outside of commissioners.
Both.
Well, I think to existing public bodies, that's a process we're embarking on at the moment to understand where there's duplication and the effectiveness on a portfolio-by-portfolio basis as part of the budget review process meetings we're having with Cabinet Secretaries going forward to understand where there is scope for addressing the complicated public sector landscape. But I think the important point, that's for the 130-odd public sector bodies. When you talk about the seven commissioners, then as I said, I think it's a very, very important point to repeat, that is for Parliament to decide what it wants to, how it wants to carry out that review, but Government's very willing and keen to support where it can.
But amalgamation of such bodies, is, whether commissioners or other public bodies, is possible, potentially?
Possible. Yeah, absolutely. That's part of the review
we're looking at.
And clearly, every portfolio and every situation is different, but the questions round about, there's a whole series of questions round about, are you minimising your back office costs through shared estate strategy, through the shared service programme for IT? Have you addressed duplication between bodies and between and government to look for areas of efficiency, etc.? There's a whole series of steps in that process that we're addressing with public sector bodies directly to understand how that goes forward. And clearly, well, there's a scenario where there's more than one public body fulfilling a particular function, of course we'll ask questions about why that's the situation.
Okay, now, I said it would be my final question, but I do want to ask one more, which is, when this process likely to conclude?
I think it's an ongoing process. So it's kicking off as part of the budget process for next, which starts, the initial work on that starts in the summer. But this is a process that will, if we do it properly, continuous improvement doesn't stop.
Improvement never stops, but always fine if you've not got a deadline for actually delivery. Then things just drag on and on and on and on, and this time next year we're still going to be discussing the same thing. Frankly, in all my years in local government and the Scottish Parliament, I've found that to be the case.
My expectation is that there'll be savings delivered in this fiscal year, or that's already happening on some parts of this, be it on estates, be it on procurement frameworks, be it on the work on IT systems and so on, so the shared services. So there's work already happening, and my expectation is there'll be more significant savings delivered that we'll identify through the budget conversations happening now for next year's budget, and we carry on from there. So.
Okay, that's very helpful. So I want to thank you very much for your evidence today, and thank colleagues for their questions. That concludes the unless I should always say, because I always do say this at the end of the meeting, unless there's some further comment you want to make or anything else you want to say at this point.
No, I think we're all good. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I'd like to give everyone that chance. So that concludes our public deliberations. We're going to move into private session. So I'll just call a 5-minute break for broadcasting and official report to leave. Thanks.